is not appropriate for children. My name's Matthew Nordhaus. I was the project director for Rock Band Blitz, and that means I was more or less responsible for deciding like what went into the game as we worked on it.
My name is Brian Chan. I'm the lead designer of Rock Band Blitz. I like Shamrock Shakes and other frosted green beverages. Yeah.
I'm Jyllian.
Chris Foster, I'm the design director at Harmonix. I've worked on several of the prototypes that led up to Blitz, and I can neither confirm nor deny if there are vocal harmonies in Rock Band Blitz. So let's start at the beginning. Harmonix's founders have talked about how, in the early days, they were looking for the best way to let non-musicians experience the joy of making music. But all they really needed to figure out how to do that was a little inspiration.
Pre-Blitz, or Pre-Blitz.
So what was the vision for pre-Blitz? Develop a new take on controller-based Beatmatch play, no instruments required. Refine traditional placement and gameplay that's been at the heart of our earlier titles. Make it accessible, but with depth for hardcore gamers. Make it driven by social competition between friends, good friends, and build the competition around exploring your DLC collection. All of these elements came through in the final demo, and all of them are key aspects of Rock Band Blitz as well. So let's give you a peek at this unreleased demo. So we felt like two-link controls might be the way to go, but we were nervous that the resulting note charts wouldn't feel musical or compelling enough. So I started cooking up some fairly ludicrous alternatives for two-button gameplay. Luckily, in the end, we authored some tests. It's often easiest just to try something and see how it works. And two lanes ended up feeling surprisingly musical and fun to play. But the problem remained, where do we map those two lanes onto a controller? And if this game ended up being multi-platform, which we were considering, how would they map to all different types of controllers?
So as we began exploring different platforms, we tried a number of different control schemes because we really wanted to accommodate, among other things, a computer keyboard. So we tried smashers on one hand, switchers on the other, smashers on the inside, switchers on the outside, WASD controls. Nothing really stuck or was very musical in nature because computer keys are kind of close together and they're made for a really soft touch. So kind of felt like you were playing like this, but rhythms are like pretty big feelings, so as the game got more fun, people were just pounding on these keyboards, and IT was wondering where all their stock was going. But one thing we did take away from that was that splitting the gem smashing between both hands like felt really good, so that was a good find.
So in the end, we went back to a fairly simple system that leveraged shoulder bugs that we knew could be really fun for this type of game, but there was a problem. The current generation of controllers, their shoulder buttons are placed in a different ergonomic position than in previous controllers. So using them for Beatmatch really hurt some people's hands, including our project lead. Pre-Blitz only realized this, really came to grips with it as the demo was wrapping up, so we didn't have time to find a solution. Another game goal was to refine the rules for locking each instrument track as you play. This is what we call the middle layer. It's the rules that exist between the most basic mechanic of hitting notes and the higher level concern of mastering strategies to maximize your score. This middle layer, or the burger in your bun, is an opportunity to create a structure of gameplay that shapes the overall experience. Here's how track locking works in Unplugged, the PSP game that we released.
As soon as my computer decides.
There it is. You play an instrument for a specific period of time, pressing a note. That locks the track to the special play itself. Give you time to move to another track, play and lock it, and so on until you have all the tracks covered. You can hear the entire song. It drives you to move through the song. We sometimes call this play spinning, which is a meaningful reference for all some plate spinning enthusiasts out there. So, our initial preference with pre-Blitz was to retain this mechanic. It's fundamentally satisfying to build up the mix so eventually you hear the entire song. We actually started refining this in the Green Day prototype, smoothing out cases where it was difficult to keep everything unlocked. But the locking rules were still too unforgiving for some players, so we tried to vary it with soft locking, where you can miss a note and not lose all your progress. But ultimately, we found that plate spinning was compelling in part because it was so unforgiving. And if you smooth out the rough edges, it's a pretty shallow experience. And even simplified, it still requires such focus that it doesn't give much brain space for you to consider other strategies or other game mechanics. In the end, we stuck with these rules for pre-blitz mainly because we just didn't have time to come up with a compelling alternative. It's a really tough problem that blitz had to tackle. So moving on, we wanted pre-blitz to have power-ups, and we wanted to move beyond an unplugged single Rock Band themed overdrive power-up. So we considered a lot of ideas. In the end, only a few of those were implemented. And but they were really useful, and they influenced the design of power-ups and other mechanics of Blitz. Yep. Those are the four that we ended up doing, which you saw some of in the demo. So the visual design of pre-Blitz is one place where we did a lot of exploring. It wasn't going to be a Rock Band game. So what would it be? We spent months looking for a unique look and story for the game. We could literally go just about anywhere with pre-Blitz, so long as things felt musical and fun. So lots of ideas were pursued, from traveling through bizarre worlds, to chasing paths of light through the city, to racing through abstract colorscapes. Even the track and interface went through broad stylistic search. And the turning point for us was when one of our artists produced this video, which demonstrated how music can build a world. This was the beginning of the musical cityscapes that carried through Blitz. In Blitz, this became a city that was reactive instead of actually popping up out of the earth. But once we had this idea, a bendy track, as we called it, that wound through a musical landscape, all we had to do was build it. We were really lucky for this talk that one of our engineers captured regular screenshots of the game as it was being developed. These are a series of images from pre-Blitz, day to day, as it made its way from its simplest form, a single flat track with dots representing notes, to the world of the final demo. You can see features come online like 3D note gems, multiple tracks, tracks that break when you lock them, to the slow development of a bending track, somewhat nauseatingly bending track, and its surrounding landscape. So the last big chunk of pre-Blitz to talk about is the competitive element. Our focus was on leaderboard-driven competition that's tightly tied to your DLC collection. The demo demonstrated this with an imagined competition between our founders. But there was one huge open question about this concept. What DLC would it use? Would it use the Rock Band music in some way? It wasn't clear. I mean, we definitely had an interest in it. We had, you know, at that point, almost 3,000 songs. But Rock Band DLC is really meant to go with Rock Band games. The problem is we needed a solid DLC strategy for this game to work. But the answer would have to wait. But anyway, back to the leaderboards. There's one thing about a game like this. If you want to beat match a competitive game, or play test a competitive game, you're gonna need to have a lot of people competing.
So what was awesome about this, and different from any other game we'd worked on before, was that it was on PC, and the dev team had made a package installer. So this is worlds away from the traditional way of getting the daily builds to people, which involves pulling down all the new files, making sure they all work together, building them, pushing it to an Xbox, turning around three times, chanting, sacrificing a chicken, and hoping it runs. But this way, it was just a package installer. You just download it every day, run it, and it was super easy. So anyone in the company could download the executable and just get playing, and like lean over to the person next to them at the desk, like, oh, how did you do on that song? Oh, there you are in the leaderboard. I'm gonna beat you. And they did, and it was awesome. All work ground to a halt. it was cool because it was announced at a company meeting at like noon, and by the time I got back to my desk at 12:30, I had like five emails in my mailbox of like feedback from people. Everybody had an opinion on the game. Everybody was talking about it amongst each other. Ideas were getting brainstormed. It was awesome. So I did what any rational person would do and download the executable and start playing.
So where did we end up with pre-Blitz? Well, pre-Blitz was fun. Wasn't perfect, but if you like this sort of game, you get a decent refinement of those ideas. Pre-Blitz was cute. We had an appealing demo to show to publishers. But there were still a lot of open questions about design, about its look, and about what music it would play. So the game had one last bit of evolving to do, which would happen once we handed the concept to a new team that would find fresh new solutions to some of these problems.
So that's where I come in. I started working on this last summer, and we took the prototype off the shelf and started again. And at that point, as Chris mentioned, we had a few issues sort of hanging over us, if you will. the control scheme was undecided, the visual style of the game was undecided, and the library of songs that we would use was undecided. But we also had a very design problem, which was, what was the strategy or that middle layer of gameplay going to be that we talked about earlier? As soon as we started realized that we were going to use this as a Rock Band game, a couple of these problems immediately snapped into focus. We would obviously use the Rock Band library, we would obviously use the Rock Band visuals. So the first one was, how do we make this work with Rock Band songs? How hard could that be, right? Yeah. So, there are 3,700 songs over three different platforms. They've been released over the past 5 years. There are at current count 14 different file formats that we use. There are export packs from hard drives and from discs, and there are DLC. So we ended up working very hard to make all that stuff work, and we're going to talk a fair bit about that later. So the next thing was the visual style. This was actually a really big win for us. We had this concept of Rock City from Rock Band 1, 2, and 3, and that really evolved in Rock Band 3 when we started doing the in-game vignettes. So we had a whole wealth of not only assets, but also experienced artists who could start creating assets for our game. And when we started having this whole thing live in the city, they started creating concept art and then building what we call plots, which go alongside of the track and blitz. And they very much created them to be in Rock City. In fact, in some cases, we literally used assets right out of Rock Band 3 and put them into Rock Band Blitz. The other thing that we got was the tone of the game, which is very much irreverent and rock-centric, I guess. You know, HMX Hellion, who does all the writing for Rock Band, wrote all of our loading tips. She helped us name the power-ups, and it really contributed to having that same voice. One other big win was the tremendous amount of design knowledge about Beatmatch visuals that exists at Harmonix. We've obviously been doing it for a long time. There's a lot of really arcane things that we have learned over the years, and although things like frame rate, which seem obvious, are crucial to making it feel musical, things like the height of the gems and how quickly the animations play when you smash them are hard-won lessons that we applied immediately. And that meant that we didn't have to start from scratch, and that was actually a really big advantage. The other thing which I want to call out is our HUD artist, Adam, the poor guy, who, despite me constantly asking for more and more explosions, managed to make the gameplay always legible. You always can see what you're doing. You always can tell what the next gem down the track is. So if you guys play Rock Band Blitz, you should thank him.
So one of the problems that we came up with was, now that the pre-Blitz project had become a bona fide Rock Band title, was that we really had to uphold a lot of expectations that franchise had created. And one thing that we were especially concerned with was the unique feel, the tactile feel of all the plastic instruments, and trying to recreate that on a gamepad controller is no easy feat. Here are several mock-ups that we made of actually instrument-specific control schemes that, so as you would move across the tracks, you'd actually be doing something slightly different with the controller to simulate the instrument. For example, for the guitar, you would do something where you would simulate holding a string and then plucking by holding down the analog stick to the left and then pressing A to pluck. So that was kind of a weird control scheme. And here is a version of the keyboard that was prototyped in the early game, where you would have three controls, left, right, and A, simulating different keys on sort of a keyboard of sorts.
So then we showed it to people.
People are fine as long as they stayed in one lane and they could get the groove of what they were doing, but it was kind of like if you were to run around a stage and just pick up every instrument, play two notes on it, throw it down, run to the next. After a point, the challenge shifted to just training your muscle memory reflexes between one or the other and not the actual gameplay.
So after all these sort of instrument-specific shenanigans, we decided just to kind of revert to a simple uniform control scheme, which was a lot like tapping on your steering wheel. So you'd use your thumbs to play left and right lanes, and it was very simple, very ergonomic. It was created a lot less strain on your index fingers for the shoulder buttons, so that the project lead's fingers wouldn't cramp up or anything like that. And we liked this one, it tested well, but we know that that control scheme is not for everyone, so we included a few other ones in the ship game, and so you're happy, you can try them out on the show floor when you play the game. So now that we had decided upon a simple control scheme, things were looking good, but it created some other interesting design problems that Nord didn't talk about.
So we had two lanes, but obviously Rock Band has five, and we have to convert the song files. So we call this process blitzification. And we actually started the process with our audio lead, who is also, I guess, a nascent programmer who wrote a Python script and actually processed the MIDI files in his audio workstation, and we would try them out in the game. And when we decided that that was good enough, we would hand it to the programmers who would actually implement it in the game. And we went through a number of different iterations, and it ended up being, I think, very successful. Like, the amount of musicality that you get out of the two lanes is really very good. So we created this two-lane gameplay, and I think it was very musical, but it did raise a couple of other issues now that we had settled on it. So here's an artist you possibly know about. So this is the same section of song four times on four different instruments. This is easy, which even for somebody who never played a Beatmatch game before is incredibly boring. There's simply not enough going on in the tracks. So here's medium again. I don't think anyone is gonna be entertained by playing a 4-minute song with this many notes on it. So this is getting there. We found that when there were more notes, people actually did better at beatmatching because they could like maintain the rhythm and get in the groove of the song. And then when we get to expert, I think is where we actually got to a place where it felt really musical. And we're hitting almost every note, for example, on the vocal track on the guitars.
Hope you guys like Jonathan Lee.
So once we realized this, one of the programmers at Harmonix who's working on Blitz proposed that we completely remove the difficulty. Now, this is my role as a project director, and this is you sort of have to be a benevolent dictator because design by committee doesn't work. But the fact is that you also can't be too precious about your ideas, and so although I thought it was an awful idea, we all agreed that we should totally play test a single difficulty and make it as difficult as we thought we could and maintain musicality.
So when stuff comes into playtest at Harmonix, we have a very scientific process. Passes through two gates of evaluation, and we video broadcast all the sessions out to our devs so they can watch them and inquire about people's various clothing choices and also brainstorm solutions. So first we playtest with the developers themselves, and they see all of our super buggy prototypes. But especially if they're not working on the game, they can give really good feedback. So then we put it through iteration, and we iterate out all the like really egregious stuff, and then we go back and with actual non-developer players. And this is where we get most of our really big deal feedback. A lot of the stuff that we're used to ignoring are like huge glaring issues to people that are seeing the game for the first time. And it gives us an opportunity to try and understand what the game looks like and feels like through their eyes. So throughout the process, we like continually revisit the questions like, what feelings is this supposed to hit? Is the game getting there for people? Is the scoring as rewarding as we hope it to be? Is the environment immersive? Can people feel the music? So there's a lot going on when people play a game like this, especially like Beatmatch has like a lot of cognitive sparks. There's musicality, dexterity, play field management. And when those skills are arranged differently in the gameplay, different skills kind of come out from the same players. So in previous iterations, most players' skills and comfort levels tended to converge around this musically significant vanishing point, which you can kind of see looking through like the easy, medium, hard, and expert versions of that same track. There's like easy, there's like nothing going on. People are kind of like moving around from track to track just to find something to do. And the notes feel kind of random. It's just kind of like one there, over here, over here. So somewhere around the middle, there's a happy medium between what musically people really want to feel and what skills they have to wield.
So basically, the playtest results came back, and I was somewhat chagrined. We did end up shipping with a single difficulty, and I think it was exactly the right choice.
So we had another problem kind of hanging over from the pre-Blitz era, and that was the middle layer, which we weren't quite sure what it was going to be. We knew that a lot of people liked the Rock Band Unplugged style track locking, but I wasn't quite sure that that was the right direction, so we had to replace it with something, we just didn't know what.
And we knew we did need something in this middle layer, because once you strip the note charts down to this simplified two-lane form, it's a lot harder to hang your game on the experience of musical performance. It leaves a hole you have to fill with something else. We actually faced this years ago on Phase. That game had similarly low-density note charts. So to keep the game's challenge and intensity up, we added rules where you needed to achieve a certain number of stars for each of the checkpoints. You could run out of health if you didn't achieve those goals. And it worked. It replaced, it supplemented the musicality of the notes with additional gameplay.
So in the past, we dealt with a lot of these issues with plate spinning and track locking. But these mechanics have always been a little problematic for players. Most people's initial reaction is, I cannot possibly hit all those notes. For other people, the locking and subsequent disappearance of tracks that they played well on kind of felt more like a punishment than a reward. And even for people that fully understood every element of the mechanic, they always felt like there was this like secret, hidden strategy that they would be able to uncover. But there really wasn't. Like, you can memorize tracks and you can squeeze scores, but other than that, they were doing it right. They just felt like they worked.
A lot of folks at Harmonix had the mentality that track locking was fine. It says we didn't need to do anything about it. We could just bring it forward for Rock Band Blitz. But I wanted to question that and see if we could evolve that to something even better. Particularly, I thought that the track locking gameplay created too much of a pattern of optimal pathing, where you had to like play exactly the right notes and with perfect flawlessness. Instead, I wanted something that was a lot more freeform and potentially more accessible, because the track locking was rather hardcore in its nature. I wanted to be able to give players the ability to both play Beatmatch and also strategize and use power-ups and things like that. So here is a very early prototype of one of the middle layer games that we set up. This is one of the failed prototypes, and it's all about setting boosting your band multiplier, which is shown on the bottom as 3x right now. As you charge each track, it gets colored in and it adds one to the multiplier. So this is good. Notice that like as you charge tracks, the notes don't go away. This isn't the track locking model. But there was something missing. Players couldn't quite figure out what the goals were when they actually when we play tested it.
And as our QA lead said, why did we ever stop using lavender tracks?
Okay, so this is a much later prototype that we had, where it is all about individual track multiplier, which is shown on the left. That you can see each instrument has its own individual multiplier. When you play enough notes in the track, it boosts up the level of the track, and then you can boost it all the way up to the level cap, which indicated on the left as 4x. So you're trying to boost up all the tracks, balance your play across all the tracks, and eventually you get to these checkpoints that are across the track. Here's a good one now. Okay, so when you hit a checkpoint, you can actually boost up the level caps. You can push the potential of all your tracks. And this has an interesting tension that it creates in the song. As you go forward, you can reach these really like insane multipliers. By the end of the song, you're going to have like 25x or something like that. And it really creates tension. Each note counts that much more.
Playtesters, let's see. So here's the first version of Brian's description.
Follow my message. You know this song?
Yeah.
And you can select one.
Okay, cool. It was a band, so he's wearing a lizard coat.
How do I choose a direction? Oh, you got
so it doesn't matter what direction I go with the
D10. You know, it's where it feels most comfortable.
I don't get much feedback on this way.
Okay. Do you know why it's firing up there?
When it is.
Yeah.
I'm assuming I got.
Maybe because I jumped off.
jumped around to different trends, but I didn't really know why we go to trends. Just fly around. Okay.
Audio removed for licensing reasons. Title of song removed for licensing reasons.
There was a lot going on, and I couldn't necessarily determine objectives. But that didn't necessarily matter because it was still really fun, and like there was enough going on that, you know, I kind of got the idea, at least, of what I was trying to do. I kind of get the point of the multipliers.
Okay.
I still haven't like totally worked out necessarily what my objective at like all points in playing through a song are in terms of like maximum scoring. But like I'm starting to kind of get a feel for it now.
So that was after his first song. The other guy was after his last of an hour playing. It was a pretty big change. So like once these things changed, a lot of the player anxiety about like where to hit, what to do, kind of dissolved. No one really sat on one lane or frantically searched around for more meaning than was present. People who were searching for an overarching strategy felt a lot more confident that whatever strategy they had developed was solid, which it usually was. So the middle layer had arrived.
So now that we'd replaced the track locking gameplay with this track leveling gameplay, we effectively solved the strategy problem, and we felt it was pretty rich gameplay, and we wanted to create more richness by implementing more of the power-ups that Chris talked about earlier in the pre-Blitz era. I'm deliberately not going to talk about the power-ups because part of the fun is discovering them and experimenting with them and trying them yourself. But you can try a few of them on the show floor today because we're going to demo the game.
So children, what have we learned today?
So game design is iterative. It's rare that you come in with a master plan for your game. More likely you come in with goals and then you make a long series of creative decisions to discover the best game possible that can achieve those goals.
It's good to fail sometimes. You know, you have to champion a vision, but you also can't be precious about realizing that the thing that you have created simply doesn't work, and learning which of those is the case is often very hard, and that's why playtesting is so incredibly important.
Design and playtest are friends. Make something, see how it works, go back to the drawing board. Eventually the right thing will come out.
Speaking of which, we are using you guys as our personal guinea pigs as we test the game on the show floor. It's, the game is in its last days, and we're now just focusing on polish and balance.
So please come by the booth, play the game, tell us what you think. We want to thank the team who's worked really, really hard on this game for quite a while. It's come a long way, and it's really exciting to go back and see these old videos and just see how far we've come. So that's all we have for today. We're happy to take questions if you guys have it, and thank you all very much for coming.
I was playing the game yesterday and I loved it. One feature that I loved about Rock Band Unplugged was the wraparound feature, and we're wondering if that might come into play at all.
It's in the code, but it's turned off right now. I actually lobbied for it. That was another case where I got shot down based on playtesting data and the general consensus of the team. But you know, that's one of those, we make hundreds of little decisions like that all the time. Probably won't make the cut.
All right. Thank you.
Yes. I don't know who to call next year. You go ahead up here.
Right. Go back.
All right.
What was the second thing?
It was. We should repeat the question. The question was, what's better, rapid prototyping or working from a game design document?
Go ahead.
I think.
You guys want to line up here and use the mic?
Oh, that would be great, actually.
Thank you.
Well, answer this one, and then only one.
Yeah, we have sort of two sayings that we fail fast and find the fun. So rapid prototyping is often the best way. Like getting an idea to the point where you can actually experience it and learn what's good and bad about it is much better than writing a lengthy design. So that's what I'd say.
Like when I started my career as a designer, I always built these huge documents, and now I'm totally in the rapid prototyping camp.
So one thing to note about Blitz is that the background where you're in a club or at a concert venue playing
is gone. And I'm curious about the feedback you got from your playtesting team about, like, you guys have always been about how can you get the most musical experience. I think one of the things I kind of enjoyed about the Rock Band games is that, you know, I feel like I'm on stage. And, you know, do you feel that that's been taken away somewhat by a lot of the, you know, the visuals in the background as the game's going on?
Well, if you look at the scene that you're kind of going through, it's you're driving down a road, and if you think back to the metaphor of, like, kind of drumming on your steering wheel, it's almost like you're listening to music on your way to the club, and, like, the environment kind of supports that.
We also found that, like, since it's more a single-player game than Rock Band, people were tending to concentrate on the note tracks more, whereas in Rock Band, sometimes you have long sections where you're not playing, and so that's when you tend to look at the venue and stuff.
But it is, I think, a conscious choice. I think that, you know, playing all the instruments, like playing them on a controller, it's less about that fantasy of being a rock star, so it felt like it was a safer place to sort of explore more, almost an arcadey presentation.
I played a game yesterday, and I did one of the songs with the big rock endings, and noticed they are in the game. How do you guys do the blitzification for those songs with big rock endings where you don't necessarily have a note chart to translate from?
Excellent question. So the answer is that we secretly chart the expert tracks for guitar and bass because they're used to control the animations in Rock Band, and we use the animation data from the drummer to drive the drum track, and the vocals get nothing.
Hey guys, first question, pretty much only question. I noticed that it's kind of starting with Rock Band 3 leaning more towards competitive leaderboard-wise, less head-to-head competitive. I work at a store where we do a lot of tournament gameplay, and we used to do Rock Band head-to-head guitar, and now we can't necessarily do that anymore. Is maybe there any possibility of getting a downloadable title of just head-to-head? Single track, guitar to guitar.
You mean for like a Rock Band head-to-head mode?
Yeah.
I think probably not. Like, we looked at a bunch of playtest data and achievement data from our servers on Rock Band 1 and 2. Did we have head-to-head in Rock Band 2? I think we cut it for Rock Band 2, is that right?
No,
it was in 2.
That was
so
just in 3.
We found that it was a vanishingly small number of people who played the head-to-head stuff, and that was the reason that we decided not to support it.
That said, we're really interested in, like, in-room multiplayer, you know, couch multiplayer, and we still think that's important to us, and, you know, obviously it's important to some of our fans, so, like, you know, we're looking at that for future products, of course.
All right.
Thank you.
Let me ask you something.
Yes, please.
In terms of...
Yes.
All right. In terms of the social aspects of the games, were you inspired by your Japanese counterparts and the way they implemented similar features in different games? I'm talking about Konami's EMUs in the arcades where you pick rivals and you start taking down their scores, or, you know, in that sort of fashion. You know, it's more score-centric versus having to have, you know, having fun like in Rock Band as always. Or did you go into a new, radically new direction in terms of interacting with your friends and going competitive?
You would take that, right? Sure. I'm not sure I'm familiar with the games that you're talking about.
It's mostly like the Bomani series, like, you know, the ones that Konami's put out. In their arcades, they have what's called the amusement, which allows you to pick certain friends that you add, and then from based on whatever scores they get, you're able to top their scores, and they're notified.
Sure. You know, we were mostly inspired by what's kind of going on in social gaming and other spaces like that, which use your existing social graph, for example, like games on Facebook and the like. You know, obviously, social gaming has other origins than that, so it could be a coincidence that there's some similarities there.
All right.
When I saw the visuals of sort of the city popping up with the music, I was really reminded of Michel Gondry's video video for Star Guitar, and I was curious if that was like a direct input.
That's a great question. I joined the company partway through the development of Phase, and I was shown at some point, actually dug through the archives, I did a talk on that game, and one of the inspirations from that game, and a version that we didn't ship, was the Star Guitar video. And in that one, so there was a version of Phase where as you played, the city would build up off to the sides, and I think that eventually we looped all the way back to that on pre-Blitz. So yeah, that was definitely, that's been a really inspiring work for us.
We're all big fans of Gondry, and we, you know, a lot of his music videos have that sort of similar theme of the relationship between the musical world and the world around you, so we're always looking at those. Thanks. That's like my all-time favorite music video, so you should all watch it.
As a classic amplitude slash frequency player for the PS2, I played Blitz, and that was a little disorientating because I was so used to the certain instruments being on certain colors. I was wondering if maybe you could match colors up exactly right because it was a copyright issue, because I think the drums were supposed to be like red in amplitude, and then the guitar was, the vocals were green, so I was wondering what was changed up.
We actually made that choice to match the Rock Band guitar green on the left and orange on the right to match the Rock Band fretboard.
Okay. Oh, so it looks like the fretboard. Okay. Cool. I'm limited to one question, right? Okay. I'll get to that.
See you soon.
I was just curious, like, how many refinements has the Blitzification algorithm gone through, and like, do you think you might have to like refine it even more after post-launch when new DLC comes out?
You know, there's always the possibility that some DLC track will show up as horribly broken, because although our valiant quality assurance gentlemen have gone through very, very many of the songs, there's no possibility, especially since we continue to release every week, that it will break in the future. I think it's gone through like three major iterations and dozens and dozens of minor tweaks along the way. But right now, we haven't found any cases where it doesn't handle the music quite well, so I'm pretty confident that we're in good shape.
So like even Raining Blood's fine, because I saw the live stream, that was pretty crazy.
Yeah, and like, you know, there are several RBN tracks that have a single track and handles that pretty well. Some, you know, non-standard instruments and so forth. So far so good.
All right, sweet, thanks.
Where do you see the more traditional instrument-based rock band gameplay going on into the future? Because Blitz is certainly, it's a great concept, and I'm glad we're bringing back the frequency amplitude type stuff. But it's been a while since we've had an iteration on the you know, the old world touring concept with five-way gameplay.
Yeah, you know, we have. There's still a vibrant community of people who love and play Rock Band 3 all the time, and we have a super robust DLC like library and a community who like loves the weekly releases. So we don't see this as a replacement for the instrument peripheral stuff. We see this as a complement to it. The whole point of using your songs in another way was part of the driver of this, to let people use their libraries and experience the music again. So I think that sort of gameplay is likely to continue sometime in the future. We don't have any specific plans right now, but
yeah, obviously you can't answer.
But yeah, this is not intended to replace that like lineage of games at all.
Yeah, because I mean, yeah, obviously the RB3 DLC will be continuing this too, but one day along the line, might be something resembling RB4.
How's it going, guys?
Hello. Well, one thing that was bothering me about like the beginning of the presentation, I saw that the early prototypes looked very similar to you know, games that you guys made, like Frequency and Amplitude, which made me wonder why you guys chose to go with the Rock Band name, because I think in doing that, you guys alienate a lot of different genres of music that both Frequency and Amplitude had, which was nice. It was nice to be able to like play and go from like a rock song to like techno or trance or anything like that. I feel like it adds a lot to the experience. I was wondering why you guys would choose rock over, you know, such a wide variety of music.
Well, I mean, that's a fair question. I think that was a conscious choice to like use our library of songs, and you know, there are a few dozen songs that were released with Frequency and Amplitude, and several thousand that were released with Rock Band. So we got the advantage of having that enormous library from day one, whereas if we had gone in a new direction with a new type of music, we would have had to go through the process of licensing it and authoring it and releasing it. And the people who had all that DLC already wouldn't have the benefit of like being able to play it right away.
But it's a fair point, because it was definitely a trade-off. Like, there are genres of music that aren't represented in Rock Band, and those earlier games worked really well. But I think overall, just the advantage of having so much music you already own accessible in this game really was the win overall.
Do you guys think that you might ever offshoot into a direction like that, into like another genre of music in the future with a similar game?
I don't know, honestly. I don't know if, we have released a pretty wide variety of music in Rock Band, and it's always possible. I can't answer that specifically.
It's actually kind of an interesting question, like if this game really takes off, it'll affect like the direction of sort of the DLC we consider for the future.
Yeah. Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
I just had a quick question about your process is so iterative about just, like you're talking about completed prototypes and testing. I was just curious if, because that process is so iterative, do your teams focus on one product at a time until you feel like it's perfect, or are you constantly juggling multiple products and multiple release dates?
Remember the picture of plate spinning? It's definitely kind of like that. There's definitely multiple projects in development at the studio. Within a project, there are usually multiple tough problems trying to be solved in parallel. And I think I actually worked with Jyllian and her team on like just the playtesting schedule of how we grind through all this stuff, and it was a pretty colorful strategy map of
awesome hard work.
Chris has his hands and his fingers in every pie, whereas like myself and we were really focused on the Rock Band Blitz project.
But Chris is right. Even within that, like we had multiple things. Like sort of we were like dealing with like a bunch of like fires at once. And so the control schemes and the library compatibility and the visual look were all happening at the same time. And so even within one project, sometimes you feel stretched in multiple directions.
We do agile development, or it's called Scrum. And so the team breaks up into different strike teams focused on it. I'm curious, like during Blitz, how many sort of scrums were there going on in the project?
We sort of had two. We had one that was concentrated on the core gameplay and one that was concentrated more on the shell, like metagame.
For every team that's broken up, that's working on different things amongst themselves, there's multiple teams going on, and the playtest department kind of just waits for them to be like, hey, we got something coming in about 3 weeks, and it's here. And it's like, okay, you, all right, you, book lab time for you. So we kind of juggle what they're juggling.
And there's layers of development, or layers of testing the game. You're not going to get to leave yet. certain things will be tested every day. Like every morning, a team will play a version of the build and talk through and decide the plans for the next day. Some things are checked weekly. Some things are checked monthly with a larger group of senior staff. So we're just constantly like watching on all this stuff and deciding what the next step is.
I was wondering, like, since you're able to use all the Rock Band licenses with this game, would you be able to make like other like future Rock Band games or future games use the Rock Band library like with different gameplay types?
Yeah, there's no reason we couldn't do this with another game if we wanted to.
So like you see yourselves making another game like that just plays completely different than like normal instrument peripherals and uses the songs?
We have to finish this one first.
Yeah, no.
The answer is if you'll buy more DLC.
Rock Band Street Fighter 2014.
I'll buy it.
All right. Regarding the instrument-based Rock Bands, there were a couple of things that I would have loved to have seen in the games that weren't there, and I was just wondering if I could just like throw out the suggestions and see if you either considered them or if there's a possibility they might go into a future game. One is, as a pianist, I thought it would be cool if the keyboards actually could do some sheet music that you could play along to and kind of sight read that. I would have really enjoyed that more than just like the pro mode note tracks that you got there. And the other is the ability to replay on a drum track during when you're playing a full band and just be able to hit any drums you want and have it actually play along.
So we had freestyle mode in Rock Band 1 where you could actually play along on your drums to any audio and trigger the drum samples that were built in. There's actually a technical problem, which is that the latency between the Xbox and your TV and your speaker system tends to make that the latency, the lag is high enough that it's usually uncomfortable and like audio-wise. it's terrible to play. And we actually talked, you know, several times about building a box that would take the direct, you know, MIDI out from the drum kit and like running it through audio so it was like in time with the music. But it seemed like a small enough like problem that we didn't think that there would be a ton of people interested in it. So that's something we've talked about in the past.
And let me also say, like, you know, the ideas that you're suggesting, which, you know, the keyboard idea and the drum idea, there's always a desire to like create much richer experiences for each of the individual instruments so that they're like much more nuanced and different. But there's this other like tension that we deal with, which is that these are band games typically, and we can't like make them individual instrument games, although that you know does have some appeal. We're always considering those different options. Rock Band games are right now band games.
Yeah, I think one of the things that that tension is expressed even in the decision about the drums. It's like if it was like a drum trainer, like you might like rewire your console to be just the thing for you to focus and learn about that instrument. But in this party game context, it's much more about immediate fun. So these things seem like the cost benefit isn't quite there overall for the project.
I had a question about earlier on in the presentation. Showed games that influenced harmonics development, games such as Parappa-Karev or Guitaru Man, things like that. Harmonix makes excellent music games, but I do see that most of them are typically track-based. Do you see any potential within the marketplace for music games beyond the track-based style gameplay? And do you think that games such as that use music as a form of storytelling, almost as a musical, do you see potential for that in the industry? Is there still room for that? And does Harmonix have any plans to maybe branch out into that direction beyond just track-based gameplay?
I think there's definitely potential for both of those ideas. And yeah, I mean, narrative in particular is one of those ones that, you know, we've always sort of had this hankering to like bring into these games, but it's a tough trade-off. I mean, we work really, really hard on refining these core systems and making them super accessible, which isn't always a priority for other studios. And that sort of resources there into the songs. And in terms of other forms of input, we're always looking for stuff like that. I think this game just sort of, once we got into the sort of instrument controller things and sort of, you know, doubled down on button-based inputs, and then when we got back to Blitz, it sort of led us back to that same thing. But yeah, there's a rich well of opportunities there.
As somebody that's a big fan of the Rock Band Network and somewhat aware of the playtest slash peer review process, I'd like to ask, for future Rock Band Network DLC, you said you took care of the other stuff that's out, but are you going to leave it up to the players, the community, the peer review to fix it for Blitz, or are you going to like take every RBN song and fix it for them for Blitz?
So sure what, I'm not sure what would be the problem with RBN songs in Blitz?
Well, because I think, now my mind is blank. I'm sorry.
Well, that's actually, maybe there's a good question in that. Is like, since RBN is coming in from a lot of different inputs, how did you guys wrestle with making sure that Blitz could handle all the different types of RBN material?
So, I mean, the good thing about RBN is that we have some pretty strict checking on the songs to make sure that they play correctly in Rock Band. So we can be fairly certain that the files and the way that they're formatted is right. And so we did a bunch of checks on RBN songs. And as I said before, like, we haven't found any that break things yet. And if we do, that'll be handled. I mean, if it works in Rock Band 3, it should work properly in Blitz as well.
And do double bass, if you have a single and a double bass version of one of those songs, would there really be a difference? Do the double bass pedal versions of songs, does that go into the algorithm at all?
No, we would have, like, our algorithm, for example, would not allow two bass notes within a certain number of milliseconds. It would simply strip it out, because you just can't hit your thumb.
So it'd be like playing the next one.
I'm sorry?
Maybe like playing the X1 version.
Yeah, probably.
Okay, thank you.
It might be a little bit different. Like, the algorithm might actually process it and make it feel a little bit different, but it wouldn't be I don't think it would be unplayable.
Okay, that's good. Thank you.
Thanks. I just had one question about, like, the movement of the track as you play the game. It's sort of like this car roller coaster type thing going through a city. And the first thing it reminded me of was, like, the rockin' roller coaster at Disney World. And I was kind of wondering if that was any sort of inspiration for that, because it really gives off that vibe of like a roller coaster going to like a rock concert.
We kind of got that from
from pre-Blitz, so.
Yeah, no, on pre-Blitz, I think we always internally refer to the track sometimes as a note highway. And that's sort of, you know, when we're trying to figure out how to visualize this thing and hang a metaphor on it, like, the road is always there. And I definitely, for a while, I was pretty obsessed with the idea of actually almost having, like, the Rock Band van be the thing that was, like, driving down the track and doing things to really nail the metaphor, and everyone said, shut up, that's kind of crazy. So we take it in this more abstracted, like, really fun visual term. I love the Rock and Roller Coaster. The catapult start at the beginning is amazing, but I don't think it was a super strong thing. Although, actually, on that front, like, that the way the track bends is actually a shader effect in code, which means it can be cranked up as much as you want, and I swear some early versions of it did feel like that roller coaster in terms of its ability to make you hurl.
First off, thank you for 5 years of so much fun. The Rock Band game, I don't think our family, our entire family, my daughter was 7 when we first started playing. She sings. My husband plays the guitars. Now she's doing the drums. Now she's doing the guitars. There is not one game on any system that has brought a family and friends together such as Rock Band. And looking at this one, I'm a little concerned because it seems more single player, head-to-head, kind of like the singing game.
Karaoke Revolution.
Yeah, stuff like that. More competition-based than bringing people together. And maybe my idea of Harmonix was skewed a little bit, but it seemed like a family, a company family made Rock Band. And are you branching away from that, or is this just one game that you're making and there's tons of others that you're going to be putting out? Does that make any sense?
Yeah, totally. I mean, like I said before, this is you can still play Rock Band 3. It's not like we're not supporting that anymore. This is absolutely a conscious choice to go in a different direction. The advantage of this is you don't need to lug your drums out from under the bed and, like, you know, pull your guitars out and replace the batteries. You just have to pick up a controller. But for people who play Rock Band, it's all that DLC is still going to be released every week. We're still supporting it. It's still, you know, as I said, like, there's tons of people on our forums. There's tons of people on multiplayer every night playing. We absolutely are continuing to, like, support that as a game. So this is a complement and not necessarily a replacement for Rock Band.
So could one person be on a controller and someone else be on an instrument?
No, it's just control. Just one controller at a time.
This is definitely going in as, like, the nature of playing with other people here is themed a little bit more after what we're seeing sort of in this era of Facebook and things where you're able to, like, play asynchronously with other people, like you're competing, like through leaderboards, and you're comparing your scores, but you're not playing at the same time. We totally love that sort of couch playing together thing, and it's core to a bunch of our games, and we'll keep exploring it. But this is an opportunity to go into this other place, and to this other type of playing with your friends.
So we're actually out of time, so can we have Mary two super quick questions, and we'll answer incredibly quickly as well, I promise.
Hi. Just going back to the visual design, what dictates the way that the note highway speaks, like the bends and the dips, and what dictates what kind of plots come out? Is that like volume information? Is that track density?
We actually analyze the number of gems on the track, like an average of it per second, and we pick different plots. So on very dense and heavy songs, you'll see more big buildings with more neon, and in quiet parts, you'll see like the parks and the small houses and so forth.
Nice, thank you. Hi there. Just two very quick questions, since I feel like the first one probably can't be answered at this point. But I was curious if there was any unlockable content in Rock Band Blitz, like what real incentives there are to playing the songs on the disc, if there is any type of campaign. I actually was one of the few people that really enjoyed unlocking songs in Rock Band 1 and 2.
All the songs are available. No, I'm sorry. All the songs are available, like, as soon as you purchase it. What you unlock is power-ups. Like, as you play through the game and you get cred, we call it its experience, essentially. The power-ups that you're able to use become unlocked, and then you can get higher and higher scores because there's better power-ups later in the game.
Okay, cool. I didn't know if there was any, like, additional modes or anything that you guys were pulling out. I, know like the discovery is probably part of the enjoyment itself, but yeah. Other quick question. I was happy to get an answer. I wasn't expecting to. I figured it was something kind of under the radar. But I was going to ask how much influence a lot of like the Facebook like dashboard app has on DLC, like it affects you guys in terms of what you want to choose to look for and chart for DLC. And I know you've probably been more than aware of knowing what's been going on with Kickstarter and stuff like that. I was wondering if Harmonix had any interest in starting one, or other things like maybe to keep people like this. I download DLC pretty regularly, and I know it's like we don't want to see that ever cease. I know it's not likely that it will. You guys have really been adamant and consistent with saying that that will continue to be to always be there. But I know like DLC has kind of slowed down a little bit to what it used to be, from big packs to smaller packs, which is still great. There's still a huge variety and stuff like that. But I didn't know if there was any like big packs or anything that people. I'm not sure how much I know like you guys make from that.
We're obviously not going to announce future DLC here.
One
thing that is happening is that one of the RBN authors has started a Kickstarter to try to license songs, like to collecting money to license songs.
I did see that.
Yeah, that was an interesting choice. And, all of the fan input is definitely one of the things that causes us to go and look for DLC. And as you can imagine, there's like a ton of complication in getting the DLC. So, it's one of the sources that we look at. So, thank you very much. Awesome. Thank you very much.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.